Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And if you're keeping up with each episode as they go out chronologically on the video, yes, I've had a beard trim. I look very swish. I've just revealed three extra chins that I forgot existed. I am joined on this episode. We're grabbing back folk from season one. If anyone remembers the Shambles episode, I apologize. But I'm bringing back one of the guys. We've had Mr. Manaville already. I will eventually get Fletch. That just leaves. It's Major Matt Wolfe. Attention, welcome. Welcome to the show.
Good evening. How are we?
I'm not too bad. We'll just have a wee chat off recording, as we always do. Just I'm very much against not telling people what happens behind the scenes of these podcasts. And you're the 160th episode that'll be going out at this point. I think everyone knows that my professionalism is still not entirely there. And I don't think it will be with the run of episodes left. But I'm glad to have you back on.
You did say that...
Sorry. See, it's going well already. We've got... See, internet connection is unstable. Wonderful start. We're not even 3 minutes in. So, grab a pack, folk, from the Shambles episode, because that was just a learning curve for myself and for everyone.
It was a learning curve. Yeah, everybody. It was... All of us were kind of deer in the headlights.
With you steering
the car.
I know, and I'm not a very good driver. My wife will confirm that I'm not very good at the driving. So it was a scary moment, but we got through it. We even had a sing-along at the end, which I still have never watched back again after it happened.
I have watched it back. It's not helped by the fact that there was a delay in between, like, everybody's Zoom syncing up. So it ended up just being like, I.
It's better to remember most, because again, I haven't went back to see it. It was when I started it and then everyone went silent because we didn't know who was going next. And that was just, no, this was a bad idea. This is the worst thing ever. But I did say I was going to bring his back eventually. And here we are, season four.
I know.
That was episode 24. This is now episode 160. So, it's been a while.
I mean, I don't think we were allowed out during the last episode, and now we're allowed outside again. So that's
Yeah, and I still don't think I have been that. I don't think I've been a collective 24 hours outside since that episode, because I work from home. I like it here. All my stuff's here. All my cool things.
Yeah, I work from home as well, and now I'm like, do I need to leave the house? Really? Okay, well, I'll do it for this short journey, and then I'll come back again.
That's it. It's like once a month, I'll go, do you want to go to Aberdeen for the night? I'll go to Aberdeen for the night. Done. That's it. That's my outing.
Yeah, I've got it out of my system now. Yeah.
Yeah. I'll now stay at home and just fester in this room again with all my cool stuff. So it's all fine. Anyway, how are you doing?
Yeah, all good, mate. All good. Just looking forward to coming on and correcting things from the Shambles and answering questions on dinosaurs and.
We'll have all that. I mean, I can't remember if we had the two sheep and one cow question at that point. I don't think we did. I think that came in season two. So we'll find out all that stuff and more. So, like I say, soft reboot. So we'll start with the classic wrestler question, podcast-y question. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was that moment that got you hooked on this wild world of wrestling?
So I think I was maybe about 8. I remember what my first pay-per-view was, and so I can't remember exactly when I started watching, but it must have been in around 98, because my first pay-per-view was the Valentine's Day Massacre in 99, the debut of the Big Show, and Bob Holly throwing Al Snow into the Mississippi River. I just sort of got hooked in around there. It was DX for me that was what I sort of bought into. It was like they were just getting away with doing whatever and then hitting big moves, and it kind of grew from there. Like, I was really into martial arts. I was really into Power Rangers and then into sort of martial arts. And then when I found wrestling, it was kind of like, oh, there's this over the top fighting that at the time to me was totally real. And I totally bought into it. And just, you never quite grow out of it, and then you end up here.
That's it. I ask that quite a lot to people when they're younger, if they don't get into wrestling, like, so maybe in their teens, whether they did like a martial art or something like that, something that kind of gets it out your system at the same time. Because I suppose at 8, just, well, 98. I don't know there's that many wrestling schools. Well, they won't take 8-year-olds anyway, or shouldn't take 8-year-olds. So it is, how do you become a wrestler? You go down to, NWA, what was it called? FWA, was it?
FWA.
So some sort of like 10-hour bus journey if you want to actually go train to be a wrestler. So you do karate or something, which I did half an hour of and then left because I was like, no, I'm happy just watching it. I saw a guy do the splits and it freaked me out, and that was plenty for me. I was like,
and that was you.
Yeah, I was like, they don't expect me to do that, are they? Oh, probably. And I had a cry and then left. So I was like, nope.
I'm not yet able to do the splits. I mean, there are guys in who I've been learning with who probably can. The likes of Judas Gray, who I know is going to be on your next, is it your next show?
That's the plan. I've got a recording tomorrow with Aspen Faith, but he'll be planning. It's going to be my penultimate episode. And then it'll be Judas Gray on Sunday. So he'll be my next episode that goes out on this. So this will be really embarrassing if he ends up cancelling and I'm just going, well, he'll be the penultimate episode. And then it turns out it's not him.
Oh, no, I've made you overcommit. It's fine. Judas will be on or I'll hunt him down. And we'll do some major justice for him cancelling on you.
We have lots of things to speak about with Judas, which we'll get to when we get to his questions for you. Because there is a... Yeah, there's something that we're going to find out that started with the Ian Skinner episode, and then this is continued with this one, and then we'll find out the answer in the next one. Hopefully, it's an arc. You've got to listen to all three episodes if you're listening or watching. You have to go check out the Ian Skinner one. If you've got a couple hours out your day, check out the Scotty Swift one because it was 2 hours 45, I think, and then we've got the next two with yourself and Judas. So it's
all Ian does love to chat. Like that is. He's a cool guy with lots of friends, and he can fit a lot of words in to a short space of time.
Ian was an incredible... We will get to you. We will get to you. It's your episode. But Ian's a fascinating one. I've had him on three times, and I can honestly say that none of the episodes are the same. The first one's like the professional one. The second one I let Ian be in charge of. And then the third one, we just let everyone else be in charge of it with the questions. So it's like nothing. It's the most weirdest trilogy of chats ever, because nobody was really behind the wheel in any of them, really. I tried to be in the first one, and that was about it. That's it. And I've already mentioned my driving. So, yeah, that was the last time I was behind the wheel of an episode with Ian Skinner. Major Matt Wolfe. So, yes. You got into wrestling through St. Valentine's and Massacre in 1999. So that was a steel cage match, wasn't it? That was...
Austin McMahon... just remembering Vince running around the ring. Now, at the time, I didn't respect what he was doing, but now that I know more, Vince's whole selling in that match was just, it was fantastic. How this big CEO, who's actually the CEO, was just throwing himself in and was willing to just do whatever he needed to get hit with, was just fascinating.
Well, the fact that he still did it, he did it again this year as well. I don't think there's anyone who's got a collective, like every match was epic in its own way, as Vince McMahon has.
I know, yeah.
Because I think it's more the curiosity thing. It's like you watch it going, is this actually happening? Is this a thing that's happening? Like if you break down move by move, if you're some sort of nerd that goes down all the moves, there's like four moves. But they're the best four moves.
Yeah. He figured out the system really quickly, and he went, right, okay, I will just do this.
Exactly. Greatest wrestler of all time. Mesh Power Rangers.
I wouldn't tell him to his face that he isn't.
he probably still batter me. He's like 74, and he's still ripped to the gills. I'd reckon he probably...
Like 3 hours sleep a night or something like that. Like I'm quite committed. I'm not that committed.
Wasn't it? I can't remember what he was lifting. Did he send a text to Pat McAfee or something like that? That he was at 3 a.m. and he was lifting like 1,000 kilos or something like that. Something ridiculous.
Come and join me in the gym. And Pat's like, no.
Insanity. If only I had the time, I would maybe be as ripped as Vince McMahon. You mentioned Power Rangers, though. And I'm always up for a bit of Power Rangers chat. So I've had guests in the past, like Alistair Karen as well, who's literally got a Power Rangers helmet. He's got two, if I remember rightly, two Red Rangers ones. What was your Power Ranger time? Was it Mighty Morphin? Did you expand past that?
Oh, it was Tommy the Green and then the White Ranger. Oh, it was Mighty Morphin. And then I didn't really sort of get past that. I think I then got into wrestling and moved slightly away from Power Rangers. So Mighty Morphin, I'll always come back to that. Always come back to the great Ivanhoe's in the film as one of the best villains. And yeah, Tommy Oliver, the Green Ranger, he'll always be the Green Ranger. I know that he's sort of come back quite a lot. But I think it was from that I ended up following because of him doing a lot of karate and other martial arts. And then from Jean-Claude Van Damme, discovered Rob Van Damme, who I honestly, for a brief period, did believe were related until the internet got slightly better and I decided to check and discovered I was massively wrong. But from there, I kind of segued from Power Rangers through martial arts into wrestling.
It's quite a jump to go from, you know, Jason David Frank to Jean-Claude Van Damme to Rob Van Damme. That's the best way.
Yeah, you just need little hops between. They don't have to necessarily make sense, but in wrestling, what does?
Exactly. I mean, we've already mentioned Pat McAfee. There's people out there that didn't realize that he's a football player, but there's football fans, sorry, American football fans. To correct everyone, American football fans are going, oh, what's Pat McAfee doing? Oh, he's wrestling. Vince McMahon. Back to Vince McMahon. Vince McMahon and WrestleMania. Amazing. And then that brings in your casual viewer. So yeah, it doesn't take a lot. It's like 6 degrees of wrestling, and it's even less than that, because somehow I've managed this uncanny skill where anything that anyone mentions, if they talk about something, I could probably get back to wrestling very quickly.
Yeah. 9 times out of 10, or worst case, you just kind of go, if you can, you go down the Mick Foley route of, well, the real world's faker than wrestling is, so like, it's fine.
Oh, that football stuff, you soccer, I'm getting confused now. It's British people listen to this most of the time. So yeah, it's like, oh, that football's fake. No, it's not fake though. Pro wrestling. And so, here's my TED talk. Right. So you go from that, you go from Power Rangers into wrestling. Who are your favorites then growing up? So you mentioned Harker Holly and also in the Mississippi River. And
DX, primarily. DX. That was my main run through. I remember Triple H turning on X-Pac. I can't remember exactly how old I was then, but I remember it breaking my heart a little bit because I hadn't really experienced a proper face to heel turn up until that moment. And It sort of just one of those first wrestling moments where you're like, no, it properly shook me. Other than that, it was Owen Hart and The Rock. Sort of when I started watching, and then it kind of progressed into like following the Ministry of Darkness stuff, and then I quite liked the APA when they became the proper APA, just beer drinking and playing cards and just getting paid to come in and help. was always really cool. I went through up until I went to boarding school, which then made it really difficult to continue watching wrestling. And I would just sort of follow updates online. It would just be WWE stuff. And then eventually I got into TNA around 2004, 2005. And then had that sort of run where I saw guys like Samoa Joe come through. Do you remember there was the wrestling TV channel?
I do. I remember the wrestling channel. I loved it.
So yeah, that introduced me to a lot of stuff. Ring of Honor, TNA, OTT, which was, OTT is the new one, is Irish Whip Wrestling, was the old one. So I got introduced to a lot of other wrestling that wasn't WWE through TWC. And yeah, gutted that someone needs to bring that back.
Absolutely, especially for a TV channel. Because, I mean, you got things like your fight and all that kind of stuff, but it's not as fun because you kind of have to, you just pick something to watch on fight.
Yeah.
Whereas if you go into the wrestling channel, I mean, I remember they used to have World of Sport. They used to have, like I said, TNA, Ring of Honor, then Noah as well. I remember that. So yeah, you could just flick on and you'd find something. That's how I found TNA as well. It was a turning point. 2004 was my first TNA show, because it was Six Sides of Steel, America's Most Wanted, Triple X with the Cage Walk. It was my first TNA.
Skipper's Cage Walk, yeah.
Yes. What a way to introduce yourself to TNA by watching that and going, oh, I'm watching this forever. That's the best thing.
It was such a good time. Like, one of my all-time, I mean, at some point, I imagine you're going to ask an all-time favorite match, or someone's going to ask about an all-time favorite match, but the Samoa Joe AJ Christopher Daniels triple threat is probably my 30-minute Iron Man that AJ and Daniels had like the month before, that it just blew me away for as a 30-minute Iron Man. I think it finished 2-2 and went to extra time, and then they added Joe into the mix, and I'm gutted that TNA didn't grow to what it could have been.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just listening to Jeff Jarrett's podcast. I'm catching up with some episodes, and they've got an episode on AJ Styles just now. They've just mentioned that triple threat, and it was like the first TNA five star match, the first one for I think the only five star match, if you believe in those things, for Daniels, and I think maybe Styles as well. So it was incredible time. And I'm just going back just from my memory, you mentioned the Triple H turn on X-Pac. Right. That was WrestleMania 15, if I remember rightly, 99. Yeah. Because that was one of the first VHSs I had was WrestleMania 15. The Raging Climax.
My first VHS was No Way Out from 98.
Oh, is that the Kane on the cover?
Yes. Yeah. Kane versus Vader. And the first time I legitimately thought someone in wrestling had been killed, Kane hits Vader with a wrench. But in 98 or 99, I fully believed that he caved that man's skull in with a wrench.
I love that.
Sometimes I miss being able to suspend my disbelief to that degree. And every now and again, there's the odd match where I just forget and I just get caught up in that like kid-like belief of it.
That's it. That's the beauty of wrestling. I know everyone likes to try and know everything about it. I mean, I suppose when you're trained to be a wrestler as well, you have to. In some way or form, but when it comes to watching it, just switch off, enjoy it. That's the most fun of it. Again, it can be harder for yourself now because you're watching it going, oh, look at the footwork, or maybe look at how he's done this. I can maybe bring that into my own kind of work. But you find you're able to kind of switch off and just enjoy a wrestling match for what it is.
And when it's good wrestling as well, it doesn't. And I don't mean that in a great technical match. It can be a great story match, like. Sami Zayn, Johnny Knoxville was fantastic. It reminded me a lot of the Big Show Floyd Mayweather one, where you know that they had rehearsed it so many times beforehand to help Floyd. But on the night, I didn't know that. On the night, I didn't believe that. On the night, it looked great. And now you get those odd matches where you can suspend your disbelief. Or now I look at it as, what can I learn? And it's actually taken me down a journey of watching some matches that I probably would never have picked. The other day, I watched some old Harlem Heat tag match from Nitro. And I was like, right, I'm going to just watch a Booker T match, but not one of the big ones. Sometimes it's easier to watch and enjoy a shorter, sort of quicker match.
Yeah, it's about finding a way to fit in all this stuff in a limited amount of time, which is, I suppose, is a skill, because you've got to kind of get a story told in 5 minutes, and it was Nitro, so probably 3 minutes. Yeah, so it's a skill that, I'll never learn, but I'm glad that it's something that people have learned, so I can enjoy watching it, which is always nice. So we went from that then. You were watching TNA on Wrestling Channel and Ring of Honor and what have you. Then, of course, TWC became some sort of fucking MMA channel. And it became less fun because it was all about the real fighting. says a bunny years ago. The real fighting. So that was over, and you had to kind of go to the internet, or if you wanted to watch anything. And you're saying the internet's gone faster. Mine clearly has not, as this podcast has gone on, as you tell me it's unstable, which is awesome. But we're going to persevere, because that's what we do here on the podcast. And
power through.
We'll power through. Even if sometimes we lose some stories, we lose a little bit of context, it's fine. Just make up the rest in your head. You can make it as wild as you want. So how did you go from that point then? So you would have found out about Irish whip wrestling. So that would be your kind of first taste of a, I was about to say UK, but that would be wrong, a European scene.
Yes.
So from there, was that kind of jumping off point going, right, so there's people near me that can do this. There must be a way for me to try this.
So I went to a military boarding school up until from 9 till 17. So up until that point, there was no option for me to be able to go and train anywhere. So I ended up doing taekwondo and competing in taekwondo for a number of years. And then when I finished, I was then sort of had the option of looking, and I spent a year down in the south coast of England, where FWA have their school down in Portsmouth, or it's not the FWA now. I think Rev Pro took over the school, but I could be wrong about that. Please don't quote me on that.
I don't know, so I'm just going to take your word for it.
So I knew about them down in that area, and I ended up working with someone who now is quite a well-known name in the British scene, but at the time we were young and only starting out, and he asked me if I wanted to come and train, and I was like, no, I actually want to go have a fallback plan, get a degree, and I don't know, I think I was a bit tentative at the time. I wasn't too comfortable living in the south of England. So then came back up to Scotland and sort of settled and did some other things. And then eventually knew about certain schools, but it was just a little out of the way, or just impractical timing. Or I couldn't drive at the time. So I was sort of limited to there not being anything in Edinburgh until Joe opened up his school. And that just, it was one of those, I had no excuses at that point. It was on my doorstep to go and do, and worst case, at least I've tried it.
So Edinburgh then, when it came to an independent scene, so you went to obviously down in Portsmouth, did you go to any independent shows at that point? Was that just a case of, right, I'm going to try a little bit of training here, or what was your kind of experience with the UK scene at that point?
I didn't know much sort of later on after 2008. So I kind of only had maybe 3 or 4 years of following the British scene, and most of it was sort of more Southern English stuff. So I knew about guys like Jody Fleisch, Johnny Storm, people like that. It was actually I went to the first Ring of Honor UK show in Liverpool in 2000, and I think that was 2005. And that was kind of what set me on, this is where I want to be, even if it's not as a performer. I want to be involved in this industry in some capacity. I had Brian Danielson versus Nigel McGuinness for the world titles. It was the first time going to like the fan fest beforehand and meeting different people. So we had like the Briscoes. There was Austin Aries was there. Just a great card. And UK guys, there was Rockstar Spud, who at one point during the fan fest couldn't quite see to the questionnaire that was going on between Danielson and McGuinness. So I gave him a piggyback just so he could see over the crowd. And right at the point I was sort of bent or knelt down for him to jump on my back, Matt Seidel wandered past in a moment that looked quite, not appropriate.
Graphic.
Quite graphic. And that was, Spud got quite ripped for trying to get some attention from a fan. He was just like, I just want to see over the crowd. So yeah, that was my first sort of smaller show, and then that got me introduced to a few British guys to sort of follow. And then in around the Scottish scene, I've not been able to follow as much. So over the last couple of years since joining Joe's school, getting to see who's out there, getting to know a lot of the companies, and seeing the guys who are performing and who I would, someone I would love to work with, has been, it's just been fun to learn about a new area of wrestling that I didn't have as much knowledge on.
Those moments, so I mentioned with Rockstar Spud and of course went on to be Drake Maverick and Matt Sydal, who's still Matt Sydal. He was out of porn for a bit. It's those moments that kind of just keep you, just make wrestling so, I suppose, accessible and interesting and cool. Because when you go back through like just moments of things, because every so often, again, not to make the show about myself because it's your show. I was listening to the Jeff Jarrett podcast, and they were talking about how amazing Sanjay Dutt was.
Great performance.
And I was just remembering that I drove him from Aberdeen to Dingwall one day, and it was like the weirdest, most surreal day of my life. But that's both the coolest thing at the same time.
Yeah, like no one else. It would not make sense to anybody who's not a fan of wrestling, or but you're like, yeah, this is just going to Dingwall anyway is normally kind of weird, but I never imagined just with Sanjay Dutt in the car next to you.
Yeah, well, him and Colt Cabana, and we were in some weird conversations about just anything and everything. And I'm just sitting driving going, oh, just want to get Dingwall, not just everyone alive. I just want to get everyone there alive. Don't crash this car answering some silly question about divas. Don't ask, just drive. But yeah, it's those things that just make things just the best. And I suppose for yourself, and so that moment with the Ring of Honor show, that must just be like, well, Ring of Honor is my company now because I've been part of the show.
So yeah, big time. Same with after I was waiting, me and my brother were waiting for a taxi, and Nigel McGuinness comes out, head still just covered in blood. And we're like, hi, Nigel, like, are you okay? And he's like, yeah, I'm just going to get a taxi off the hospital and get this checked out. And I was just like, I've just seen you go through a war. With Danielson, and you're just like, I'm just gonna hang out and then get a taxi. And I was like, oh, so the glamorous world of wrestling. But I just remember looking up at him. I know I'm actually about the same height, if not a bit taller than Nigel McGuinness, but at the time he was just the biggest person I had ever been next to. And he just had this aura about him. And you're just like, all right, yeah, just getting a taxi in my gear. Bloody head.
Yeah, wrestling's weird.
quite strange.
And then yet all of us watch it and like it and do it, and it's like when you try and break down like the schematics of what wrestling is and the afterwards and all that, people maybe are quite rightly to go, that's a bit weird why you're doing that. Why do you enjoy this? I don't know, I just do. That's just that, like, I have
is it fighting? Well, yes. Is it also like a dance? Yes. Is it like a comedy show? Yes.
A pantomime? A little bit. Yeah. It's all those things rolled into one.
I've seen physical feats done that I never thought were humanly possible. And I've seen a giant turkey come out of an egg in the same evening. You just can't really summarize that. For people, which is why when you get the what do you do? Oh, I wrestle. And you get the look.
Yeah.
Which is the same look every wrestling fan has ever had when you go, yeah, I'm a fan of wrestling. And they go, what's wrong with you?
Like, it's almost like they have two states of mind. It's either you're either Stone Cold Steve Austin or you're Doink the Clown. There's no in between. You're either
no middle ground.
Or you're Stone Cold Steve Austin. No, you're cool or you're Doink the Clown. It's just a very weird. Doink Clown was cool if anyone tries to say otherwise, but still in the
ground, like angry scary Doink was pretty cool. I think that's a killer clown.
I know, I hate clowns. I'm scared. I liked Happy Go Lucky Doink. Yeah, Dink. what's not to like? It was with a little clown that if it scares you, you can just kick it. Anyway, so Edinburgh, you're up to Edinburgh. So, school, So did you go to things like Discovery? Because they were based in Edinburgh. WTL was came to Edinburgh a couple of times as well. Or...
So I had been aware of Discovery, but I never quite got round to going to shows. I always quite liked the idea of having a smaller company on my doorstep. Because I've been aware of ICW as the main one. And I'd come across Reckless in Tent a few years before when I'd been looking for training schools. But again, they were just it wasn't practical for me to get through there. So it wasn't until, again, Ring of Honor did their first Edinburgh show at the Corn Exchange, I want to say 2016 now, kind of lost how much time has passed due to COVID and when years actually, what happened in what year.
While you're continuing, because I think I may have the results for them on the site, because of course I do.
Possibly. See. I know that Joe faced Silas Young.
Oh, okay, yeah, I may have them somewhere, but yeah, I know what show you're on about.
So it was that show because I was like, oh, they're coming. I've not seen them sort of for years. It would be awesome to go and sort of see them again and take my wife, the good lady Wolf, with me to a wrestling show for the first time, so she can experience the weird. The greatest atmosphere you can get is being at a wrestling show for me. Like, it's better. A gig, kind of, certain gigs can come close, but even a poor wrestling show is guaranteed to be fun. So we went to Ring of Honor, and that was actually the first time I became properly aware of who Joe Hendry was, and, like, the whole local hero chant started coming out. And then I was just kind of like, oh, there's a Scottish guy wrestling for Ring of Honor. Okay, I've not followed Ring of Honor enough over the last few years. Who's this guy? And the match was great. And then from there, I was kind of started following Joe a little bit more. And then that's how the school sort of came about. And then from there, discovered all these other sort of FCW and WrestleZone and all these other companies that I was like, oh, I could have been going to all these smaller shows on a Saturday afternoon, but I didn't know there were so many on.
Yeah, it was when I started the website, I didn't realize how many companies there was, and it's just expanded since. It's like, literally, there's a show a weekend just about now. If you had the energy and the pennies to do so, you could probably be a wrestling show every week if you so wish to be. I'm just going back up a bit. So you were married before you introduced Mrs. Wolf to a wrestling show.
I introduced her before we got married.
Right.
But we've been together, I think, 11 years when we got married.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. That's right. Because I was about to say, did she put it off a lot? And then by the time you got married, she was like, oh, okay, I suppose, better come.
No, she had sort of liked wrestling when she was younger. And then I stayed a lot more committed to wrestling than a lot of people do. As you find with wrestling fans when you get to sort of our age, there's a lot of people have sort of fallen away. So she remembered the bigger characters, The Rock and The Undertaker and that. So then when we started watching again, she started, she was like John Morrison. And my way of selling it back to her was, you really like Hollyoaks. Well, this is just Hollyoaks, but with some fighting. And that was my selling point for it. And since then, we've done a few shows, and she very kindly took me to WrestleMania for my 30th.
Nice.
So she is fully on board with wrestling now.
Yeah, my wife is on board with going to live wrestling. Most specifically, she'll go to WrestleZone because she knows all the characters, she likes the characters, and she knows she's in for a good, and she gets to go to Pizza Hut. So it kind of balances out.
That's always a win.
But my selling point was, for her first show was a Regal Rumble, because I sold it to her as going, it's about 20 guys, and the aim is to make sure you're the last one standing, you throw everyone over the top rope. She's like, that actually sounds ace. Let's go for that.
And it is. Any Rumble is always good fun.
Always. And she's come back to other shows, and we're trying to get her mum to go to a show for her 60th, which is this year, but things happened. She meant she couldn't go. And Kelly's first thing was like, it should be a Rumble if you're going to any. It's a nice, easy one for you to understand. Yes, I've linked you into my cult now. Yeah, if you're selling anyone to go to a wrestling show, it's a Rumble that reels them in.
Family tradition of your first one has to be a Rumble.
Absolutely, every time. I think she found it weird because every year I would stay up for the Royal Rumble. That was my one a year. I would stay up for that. I would say I wouldn't stay up for WrestleMania, then end up staying up for WrestleMania and not taking the day off afterwards. And
I take the day off after for Rumble and Mania. I used to do it for SummerSlam as well, and then you couldn't commit to all of them.
I learned that, yeah, I always took the Monday off after the Rumble, but I always, for about 2-3 years, I said, no, I'm not going to watch WrestleMania live this year. And then it gets to the day, and I go, ah, you know what? I'm not that tired. I might as well just stay up for WrestleMania. And then Monday, I'm like a zombie, and I am an absolute grumpy cat if I haven't had much sleep. So it's the last couple of years I've taken the Monday off because it's been two nights. So I can't do it two nights in a row now.
This year was the first Mania that I was like, yeah, I'm not watching the Saturday night live. So I watched the Saturday on the Sunday. Monday, I was like, I didn't have enough time to watch the entire second day on Monday. So it was like, right, I'm just going to pick and choose matches, because you can't, for certain pay-per-views, you can have media blackout yourself for a day. Mm-hmm. I've even managed up to 3 days. But for a Mania, you can't. It's just everywhere. BBC is the one time, like, BBC news is like, this happened at WrestleMania. My wife's like, don't look at my phone.
Stone Cold Steve Austin. Stone Cold Steve Austin's back. Ah, no! but yeah, that's it. And well, I suppose with working from home now, I've watched every pay-per-view. Well, except I've only missed the horror show at Extreme Rules last year. It was the only WWE premium live event I've missed since the pandemic started.
Nope,
and that was because I was... Oh, did I disappear for a second there? Oh, yeah, frozen.
Yeah, we're back.
We're back. Excellent. We're back. That's fine. It's not a long enough gap for me to necessitate cutting it out, so it's all good. So, I was saying that, yeah, the only one I've missed is horror show at Extreme Rules last year. Was the only one I missed watching live. And then the rest of them I've seen because of work from home, so I can just roll out of bed and look like utter shit and be at my desk in 2 minutes. And it's amazing. You're frozen again for a little bit. I'll eventually tell the story. That's fine. Everyone else has heard it. My internet's gone a little bit funny again. So I think we've got a little bit of the backstory of how you got into it. We've got some questions in while we're still here. And then we'll get into the actual the embryonic stage. We've done that. That's the bit we're at. The evolution into Major Matt Wolfe.
Oh, yes.
So let's see what we've got here. It's a lot of army related questions. So let's maybe find one that's not so much. We've got Ian Skinner, who sent in loads, but we'll start with this one. He's put Ask Matt Wolfe. Didn't even use Major. That's disrespect straight there. Ask Matt Wolfe.
Eight straight away.
Yeah. Ask Matt Wolfe about his favorite wrestler who are 5'8".
So every wrestler is 5'8" in comparison to me. And I plan on challenging every supposed big man in Scottish wrestling, and then we'll march on to British wrestling, to a match. Loser is 5'8". I am. The Major is the biggest, or at least the tallest, wrestler in Scotland. I will prove it by making everybody else 5'8".
I like the idea that it's like Crash Holly in his super heavyweight stage. Yeah. You just come in with a tape measure, and it doesn't matter where you put it. It just says 5'8". And that's it. It doesn't matter if it towers over you, 5'8".
5'8". Every time.
You don't wrestle anyone below 5'8".
No, after that, never again. I'm just like, nah, you don't measure up.
Oh, no, 5'7", definitely not ready to wrestle the Major. There's money there. There's money to be made. I don't know what you guys are doing at the Joe Hendry School, but everyone comes out with some amazing ideas that I've heard, and likes of Ian as well. But yeah, things with
in general. I probably couldn't take. I think Ian. Yeah, I think Ian would take most of the credit and for the 5'8" fight. And to answer his question, Ian Skinner is my favorite 5'8" wrestler.
That's what I was hoping for. But yeah, I've not enough good things about to say about Ian. But if anyone's, again, up to this episode, go back to Ian's one, because he comes up with some amazing ideas for a wrestling show that he wants to do in the future, including...
Ian Skinner's Big Birthday Bonanza.
Yes. He called it that, and I was offended because I've got my day of birth bonanza. But he mentioned that something about soup. For I don't want to spoil it for everyone, but there was something about soup, and there was he mentioned in a previous episode. APW Austin Powers Wrestling, Austin Powers APPW. That was the Austin Powers Pro Wrestling. I'm very afraid of what goes on in Ian Skinner's mind. I think that's pretty much the overarching story of this.
You should. Be in a car with him. It's an experience that can only really be spoken about inside the car.
Right. Okay. That's fine. It's one of those where you come out and you think, was I on LSD throughout that?
You get out and you're like, I've just had an hour's input into Ian Skinner's mind, and I don't know what to do with that.
Love him. Right, so that was a nice question to ease us in while we're still not even at Major Matt Wolfe in your first day of training. We're about 45 minutes in at this point. So you started with Joe Henry's wrestling school. Of course, you got your background a little bit in Taekwondo, a little bit of karate. You can do judo chops and what have you. So what was that first couple sessions like? Was it all a bit real at that point, or do you think you're ready for it?
I didn't feel ready for it. It was kind of one of those where I was hoping to improve on my fitness, really. It was more just fun, just picking stuff up and having everybody at a similar level. So I know in previous episodes you've discussed the two main classes that Joe Henry had. The first class with the likes of Sharky Fossil, Judas Gray, Awesome Rob, Jareth Duke, and Erudite James Erdos. Let me try and name drop everybody. And then from my class, I had the undescribable Mr. Manable, Big Chez, Ryan Richards, there's me, and I think there was somebody else. There was Ricky Dodgerson as well. I think Fletch came in with us, but I think he maybe joined maybe not exactly the same time. Can't remember when Fletch joined. So yeah, and then it was very much because we were all in a similar position, just doing simple things like a lockup was great, and just being... It was scary, and you're kind of like, oh, I'm doing it. Oh my God, there's so much more going on to this than I actually realized there would be. It's kind of like driving for the first time. You're just like, ah, there's just things everywhere, and I'm trusted. And then everything improves, and you get slightly better. And then one day they're like, go and do a flip bump. And you're like, no, I'm 6 foot five. I don't do that. And then they're like, yeah, you just do this, and then you do it, and you're like, I survived. I gotta do it again. And then you just kind of get that bug, and then you're hooked. And Joe's been sort of really good at building this environment in the school where there's no egos. There's no one who is better than anybody else. In Joe's eyes, he wants to work with everybody, and he sees where everybody's different strengths can take them. And he knows that there's a position. Like, I'm not going to be doing flippy high flyer stuff. It's just not. I could maybe learn one day, but it's not really going to happen. So I know that there's people there that Joe's aware of who will fit that role, and then there's my role that hopefully I'll get to take more on.
That's what I've learned from speaking to folks that have been through the Joe Henry School. That he does. He's very good at focusing on your strengths and then maybe trying to help with your weaknesses, but if you can get your show ready on your strengths, then that's half the battle sorted, kind of thing, which is fantastic. And of course, guys like you've got Dave Conrad as well, that helps with some more of the the technical aspects if required, and that's, you're ready for anything. It seems like a really great atmosphere and school is put together. What kind of date time were we looking at that when you started then with Joe Henry School?
So that was, I think, honestly, around 2000. I think it was maybe February of 2020.
Right, right.
Yeah, I think around the February of 2020. And then again, we sort of had 7-8 weeks, and then we went into the first lockdown. So then that sort of scuppered. We'd all made so much progress, and then that completely scuppered us. And it was, okay, well, we'll wait out a couple of weeks, as everybody thought it would maybe pass or just be a more fleeting thing. And then it didn't, and we all stayed. So it was, right, how do we continue working? And Joe really wanted to, he showed a great commitment to us all in being like, look, what else can we work on? What else can I get you guys up to speed with and get ready for? And then when we can get back doing physical stuff, we'll pick that bit up. That bit can also be learned, but there's, you know, it's not just the physical part of wrestling. There's the character and the performance side as well.
That's it. And again, that's something that a lot of the guys from Joe Henry School, they became very prominent on Twitter anyway, with yourselves and of course like Ryan Richards, Big Fletch, Manaville, doing all these kind of promos, because like I think I was saying to Manaville as well, so it's like you maybe thought it was gonna be a couple of weeks, so everyone was doing one a week, cool, and then eventually you're thinking, oh no, this is a lot longer than I thought, and I don't know whether I need to do more or stop at this point. I don't know, and some people just kind of hung back and maybe just put out maybe one a month, and then we've got Ryan Richards, who was just continuing to get his name out there and riling folk up by having no matches but saying he's the best ever, and he's just there's two ways that was kind of how it went. It's either you fully commit to it or you go, no, I want to get the wrestling bit done and then I'll come back and do the speaking bit. I suppose with that as well, we did our tournaments, which kind of again brought a lot of people until promo battles and what have you. So
it was good fun. I mean, two-time finalist, I believe I was. Two-time finalist.
I think you were. Yeah, I think it was at the
one-time winner. I won the. Did I win the tag one?
I'll find out. That's because
I was definitely a finalist twice, because I know that Fletch his gang.
Twitter tournament. Let's see if I've still got the results somewhere, because I'm sure I've got a page of them. Of course I do. Right, okay. So let's see. On the old website, we've got, you won the Saltire Classic. That was with Brent Carter.
Yes.
Tag team one. Let's see. Survivor Series, you were the finalist against Fletch. And you must have been the finalist in the Mega Tournament of the Doom sequel, I'm guessing. Let's see. No, it was Brody that was the finalist in that one. Okay.
Yeah.
So, yeah, must have.
I think I got knocked out by Fletch in like the first or second round.
Quite possibly.
I just can't. That's my. He's now my main rival in wrestling. Because now the matches are back. Now I can actually put right the two losses from the tournament. But the tournaments were great. They were great fun. It was also a nice way for me to be introduced to other people in Scottish wrestling, and to kind of know who's about in the scene and who else is sort of coming up, who's a little bit ahead of me now. It was great to sort of get to know people like Brent Carr, to see Brody Adler and Brody and Mr. Manaville sort of hit it off during that time. It was great fun to do, and obviously I'm willing to do whatever it takes to pimp my dog out to win tournaments.
It worked most of the time.
I was like, you know what people love? Dog picks. Right. Okay. Let's get the staff sergeant doing some stuff.
Always wins. I keep forgetting to do it, mainly because Sandy now just refuses to come down and watch wrestling with me. But usually I would try, if I was watching the Thunderdome or pay-per-view nights, or get a picture of her asleep. But she, it didn't take long for her to go, no, I may stay up for this. I'm going to bed. You could come with me if you want, but it's 10:30 and I'm going to bed now before the show starts. But yeah. Nothing kind of tops dog picks. If they're always good. They're always good boys and girls. You can just do that anytime. So I mean, I'm assuming Staff Sergeant got plenty of treats for help.
He ended up on a diet after, because he did end up putting on about 2 kilos. So we were like, okay, let's maybe less treats. But he was a very good boy throughout all the filming and photos and stuff. And he honestly has quite a mean drop kick.
Yeah, I know. My dog's got a great Superfly smash.
But I'm yet to be able to get the... Yes.
I was basically, I said Superfly Slash, and thought, oh, it's got Slash as well, but that's a different Martin Taylor.
Very different move.
A little bit, yeah. Brent Carter has asked, how is Staff Sergeant doing?
He's doing well. He was a little sick, actually, a few months ago, but has improved, and now is I can say, a very good boy.
Good to hear. We'll just continue with his questions. We've got, which of the commando elite from Small Soldiers do you have the most in common with?
It would have to be Major Chip Hazard.
But classic. Nice.
I mean, not only are we the same rank, we also lead by example. And we will wipe out the Gorgonite scum.
God, I've seen Small Soldiers in years. I used to be one of my Christmas films. Like, you'd watch it every Christmas because it was on. That was a favourite in this house. That and Jingle All the Way. Brent,
it was on a couple of months ago, and I insisted that we had to have it on. And then, we had it on a couple of months ago, and then I insisted that my wife had to watch it. And then earlier today, she was like, "Who are the Gorgonites?" And I was like, "Just no,
right.
No."
We're going back to the streaming service.
Right, we're going to be watching it again.
You clearly did not learn anything from this, and that is the Gorgonites are scum. Right, and he's also asked, do you know the dance to Crank That Soldier Boy?
I don't, but if any companies are willing to give me a title shot, then if I win the title of any company, I will do the Crank That Soldier Boy dance.
There you go. I think if there's any other reason to give Major Matt Wolfe a title, then that's it. That's the only reason you need.
Yeah.
Right. So, of course, you did the promos, and Major Matt Wolfe, of course, it lends heavily to your experience, your growing up and being in a military boarding school. Was that just something you were able to just go, right, this is me, crank up to 11. Joe kind of, is that kind of Joe's
It's kind of, he was like, try and come up with a character and try and come up with something that, isn't too complicated. Some of the ideas that I would initially sort of throw out at him, he was like, yeah, but Matt, have you won the lottery? Then you can't do that. We just can't, like, it can't physically be done. So I was like, okay, well, I'll scale back. And the character of Major Matt Wolfe, is actually based on both my dad, who was a major in the military police, and my grandfather, who was a sergeant major in the military police. So it's both like a homage to them and my personality sort of turned up a bit. It's just a way of sort of getting creative and putting something out there, but within the realms of like, this is a world I know, this is a world I want to pay homage to. And my wife always said that she didn't want me to join the army at all. So this was my way of both kind of doing it and without having to go away for weeks at a time.
So is there anyone you kind of took to kind of get into that character, much like Major Chip Hazard, but I don't know, Sergeant Slaughter or something like that, and he's Stolen Valor. But is there anyone else that you kind of went, I want to see that. I think I may bring that a little bit. I'm trying to think of any more. We got Gary Pittman from WCW. That's probably not a great example either. there's not like many great arm gimmicks, I'm realizing, in wrestling. Was the Stalker?
No, it's not an overly done. Yeah, it's not an overly done gimmick. It's not an overly done gimmick, which is actually quite good for me, because I mean there's been a few zombies. I know of a couple of pirates, but yeah, other than Sergeant Slaughter, there's not. There's Lacey Evans,
Earth, yeah.
and her current gimmick is not even a gimmick. It's actually her, and I'm kind of like, it's very, very close. We're both doing very similar things, so like it'd be great to work with Lacey Evans at some point. That could be a dream. Yeah, there's this sort of Sergeant Slaughter there. I mean, Harlem Heat, sort of Booker T had
G.I. Bro.
Yeah. So there's a few things to sort of watch back and call back upon. Big Boss Man as well. Like, yeah, like not a soldier, but very similar.
Truth Commission.
Similar style. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I'm only thinking that because of the beret, to be honest. That's
even a bit of like Right to Censor, it's sort of in there. So yeah, there's things, but really, Sergeant Slaughter is the epitome of a wrestling soldier.
Right. So what we're getting, we talked about Truth Commission for a moment. I brought them up. You said Right to Censor. Really, do you want to be the Bull Buchanan of Scottish wrestling? You know, big guy, scissor kick.
If that's an option for me, then yes, I will.
I love Bill Buchanan. He was like the best thing in WrestleMania 2000 with these big jumps and all that kind of stuff. But everyone's 5'8" to him as well. Right. So, my internet goes back on.
I'm pretty sure it's Bill Buchanan in The Girl Next Door. Which is an Emile Hirsch film with, I forget the actress. She was in 24. Alicia Cuthbert.
Oh, right. Okay.
Yeah. And I'm pretty sure it's Bull Buchanan who has like a random cameo in that.
I was really wondering where that was going because The Girl Next Door does not sound like
It is a perfectly PG-12 film. But it is kind of based around what you imagine it's based around.
Okay, that's fine. Because I remember, Luther Reigns maybe appeared in a similar-minded kind of film. But it was definitely not PG-13. But like, it could be totally slandering Luther Reigns at that point. So I'm sure you'll listen and you'll be just absolutely just disgusted. Right, we've got loads more questions about just general arminess, so we'll get through those.
Yep.
We've got Ian Skinner back he loves a question about this, so we'll do the two that I've got on a separate page here. I've got thoughts on General S. Patton. That is his favorite military personnel.
So I'm a big fan of General S. Patton. He has a number of quotes that I like to live by, and one in particular that I feel stands strongly for me in wrestling. I am a soldier. I go where I am told, and I win when I am told.
That pretty much is a good encapsulating in wrestling kind of quote.
And I think General Patton would have been a formidable wrestler. I imagine like a Bob Backlund. He would have been more like that.
Right. Okay. Cool. And he's also put thoughts on Captain Oates.
Possibly could have been saved on his ex whilst he was exploring and trying to reach the South Pole. Probably didn't have to wander off into the snow, but he was only a captain. You can't trust them to make all the right decisions, which is why we have majors.
I love this. This between yourself and Sharky, that you're so knowledgeable on the most random thing. Well, not random. You're like, you've picked a subject, you picked a gimmick, you picked a character, and then you're all in with it, with the characterization in the history. That's great, because I asked, got loads of questions about like things, seaboard things for Sharky, and he was like just rattling off all these facts and answers, and I'm like, If you ask me anything, maybe it's outside of wrestling and possibly Marvel films, I am useless. I have no information for you. But yeah, it's just, yeah, great. I enjoy these kind of things. Speaking of Sharky, he has asked advice for battling giant squids.
I mean, if the giant squid's got up to me, then the giant squid is on land. And I recommend for battling a land-based giant squid, a wizard.
Fair. I mean, like, yeah.
I don't know. If a giant squid has got that far, I'm assuming that a wizard must be nearby or in the vicinity who can come and deal with the giant squid to get it back. If it's fighting a giant squid on sea, then I revert to Sharky's superior naval knowledge on how to destroy it. Otherwise, I'd probably just shoot it.
Just keep shooting.
Just keep shooting.
Eventually, one of them will work. That's the thing in films I find hilarious, when they're like shooting Superman and none of them work. I'm like, why are you bothering?
Yeah.
The first five hasn't worked. I don't think the sixth one's gonna, and I don't think the 60th will either. So let's maybe not. Maybe stop shooting him. That might be a good idea. So we'll go back to Ian Skinner, because he loves a question. He's put favorite military
general.
So you mentioned Patton earlier. Is he up there, your favorite military general?
No, he just has a lot of, he's very quotable, is General Patton. My favorite military general would be Napoleon.
My. Heard of Waterloo, he did surrender. Right, we've got favorite flanking maneuver.
So I would probably say Hannibal at the Battle of Cannae, where he invented the pincer movement of flanking on either side. It's become known as the pincer movement. Originally, it was going to be known as the holy moly roly poly, but it just didn't really fit for in a Latin translation. So they went with pincer movement instead.
See, educational. These podcasts are educational. You learn that the internet up in Elgin is absolutely horrific, and you learn facts about stuff as well. So it's the best. It's I don't know why I'm giving up.
Every now and again, there's a delay.
Yeah, I know.
Every now and again, there's a delay, and I can't work out whether to pause and wait or whether the pause and wait is over.
Yeah, I've kind of got the same. Yeah, and then when I eventually start speaking, you start speaking because you've paused long enough thinking, It's a bit of a mess. I sometimes wonder thinking, oh, I could keep doing a bit more after my planned stopping, and then I get episodes where the pause is too great. I'm like, no, I'm not doing any more. That's it. It's over.
Yeah.
The podcast is done because the internet just does not want me to do it. So Vodafone, fuck you. Right. Yeah. So there we go. That's my only F-bomb I'll try and drop in this episode. We've got Liam Stewart. Liam Stewart's asked, who'd win a fight to the death between Master Chief, G.I. Joe, Captain Falcon, and the Thunderbirds?
Well, the Thunderbirds wouldn't be in the fight because they only do search and rescue. I would say this will upset a lot of people, but Master Chief is a bit of a bitch. Hashtag go Sony. So I would have to say it depends on which G.I. Joe that gets to be in the fight. I think most people would expect me to choose or one of those, but actually I would pick to win in this fight to the death against Master Chief and the Thunderbirds. It'd be Snake Eyes. So yes, G.I. Joe, but Snake Eyes G.I. Joe would win that fight to the death.
What if or Judas Grey also added, or the Red Ranger? So if the Red Ranger was in the fight,
I would still say Snake Eyes.
Okay, for myself, Duke Nukem. You throw him in there, does that
make sense? You know what, Duke? Like he would do it from distance, and probably drive over them really fast in some sort of sports car whilst dropping a nuke on top of them and smoking a massive cigar.
There you go. So Liam, there's the answer. Between those four options, it's Duke Nukem. That's going to win. All right. We've already answered Sharky's one. We've already answered Brent's one. Awesome Rob. Awesome Rob Stowe, who, again, another guest I'm hoping to have on in the next couple episodes. So he's I started the podcast way back when with loads of FPWA guys. I seem to be ending it with all of Joe Henry's Edinburgh School guys instead. So nice little balance going on there.
It's a great way to end as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So he's put major statements or generalizations.
So major statements always beat generalizations. I appreciated the salute there. My wife would be gutted that I didn't do this. Is the one time that I didn't do it.
Are you a How I Met Your Mother fan with that? Because that's how you started that.
I actually have applied twice to go on Mastermind with that as my specialist subject.
Oh, nice. So you'll appreciate like one of my newest tattoos then, which is...
Oh, yes. And why is it called that?
That's the puzzle.
That's the puzzle.
Yes. Love it. When I got that, when I told my mate I was getting that, I went, I'm going to get the word puzzles. And he literally turned to me and went, why puzzles? I was like, yes. This is worth it. This is worth it.
And you're like, it'll never happen again, but that one time.
Oh, yeah. I mean, absolutely worthwhile. It was half an hour of getting a needle in my arm in Scrubs font to say word puzzles for one joke. In a joke you don't even really remember in a TV show, unless you're both of us who loves How I Met Your Mother. But yeah, it was absolutely worth all that time and effort and pain. So, what camo is best camo?
It's my go-to comfort show. Like, I probably rewatch it once a year or so, just all the way through.
I like how our pause is struck. It made that answer really weird.
So dramatic.
So what camo is best camo?
John Cena.
Fair. That's fine. Yep. Not more we could really add on that, because, you know, you can't see him. And Awesome Rob's ended that. His three questions.
We're back.
Are you sure? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we're in time. We're in sync.
In time.
Excellent. I'm Joy Fatone. We're in sync. Who's Awesome Rob has ended that with a really nice, poignant question. Who's your biggest inspiration?
In wrestling, it's probably DDP. I actually got into WCW towards the end of his run. I didn't see as much of his wrestling, but everything he did after and knowing his story, he's by far my biggest inspiration. Plus, he didn't make his debut. He didn't have his first match until he was 33, and the Major is now 33. So I'm finding quite serendipitous to be following DDP on that journey. I'm also a big fan and believer in DDPY. It's just a fantastic program.
I tried it for a week during a pandemic, and that my all my muscles ached, and I thought, I'm not trying to be anything tried to be fit or doing anything sporty. I'm just gonna leave it for a bit. I'll come back to it. I've got all the things, so I'll eventually come back to it somehow. Right, I'm just waiting for everything to catch up, just to make sure we're not doing awkward pauses, and then we've got Judas Gray's mad questions.
Yeah, I think we're back.
Cool. Right. Judas Gray. Right. So this is some stuff that we'll get proper answers to in the next episode. So like you have said that you'll try and not give away the whole thing. Right. Now I know it seems so awkward to ask these questions. Okay. Have you found your experience in DMG helpful with moving forward in all aspects?
I would say yes. My time in DMG, whilst not always enjoyable, has helped me move forward with aspects of my life.
Wonderful. I can't wait for the context for this next time. And he's also asked that, would you recommend DMG to a friend?
Well, I had to sign an NDA given to me by the CIA around DMG. So due to the DMG NDA CIA, I can't disclose any further information.
Wow. Right. Okay. And he's left with, left with two questions, but we've got LFI versus the dismissal. What's better?
So the dismissal is better. LFI is Judas's finishing move, whilst the dismissal is my finishing move. Granted, people have now seen and can see his match from Wrestle Carnival against Joe Hendry, where he does hit the LFI at one point, and soon enough, people will be able to see me hit the dismissal on many a future opponent. So it's going to be the dismissal, and he is now dismissed from my army for that question.
He did leave one more, and I think this is a good one, though. Good one to
kinda, okay. We'll let him back in for one more question.
One more. It's a good one to kind of to end this questions section on. He's asked, just dream match. So, what's your dream match?
I don't know. I mean, a match against DDP would be cool. Is it a dream match against of all time?
Well, I've got a question.
Do they still have to be competing?
I've got a question about competing ones later. So we'll go just dream match of all time. So anyone, past, present.
Okay, dream match of all time. I Nigel McGuinness. I would love to have gone up against Nigel McGuinness in his prime. Just not only one of the best British wrestlers we've had, he was also at the time one of the few British wrestlers who I found could really speak. Could really cut a promo, was really good on the mic. And I think it's those wrestlers who seem to have got a lot more time on TV in the States. And whilst a lot of British guys technically are so good, they don't always have like the commanding voice in promos and things like that. So they get across from their matches, but Nigel could get it across in both. So, yeah, I think Nigel McGuinness would be a dream match.
So we've spoken about everything coming up to this point, and obviously getting to training and doing the promos and what have you. Do you know when your first match is going to be? Have you had a discussion, and do you feel like you're ready for it?
So I've been told a preliminary date, but I'm not going to disclose that just yet, because to be honest, I don't want to jinx it. And you know, with any of these things, not every it will hopefully be this year for sure. And I think I'm as ready as someone can be for their first one. I just want it. I want it to go as well as it can. But overall, I just want to go out and entertain and have fun and just do something a bit different that I've always sort of said I was going to do. And yeah, just looking forward to that chance to actually finally have said it and done it.
And batter all these 5'8" wrestlers. That's the goal as well.
All of them, like 5'8". They all call themselves big as well.
So we've kind of, we'll have a fancy question. We talked about your dream match as well, we'll get the big questions out of the way, because for those that haven't listened to the Shambles episode, I'm fairly certain I asked this question, but for those that are unaware, what's your favourite dinosaur?
For a pterodactyl.
Nice choice.
So, yeah, I was going to go down the whole do you think Isaurus route, the famous blind dinosaur, but I was like, how dad jokey can should I make one thing? And I was like, no, I'm going to go safe for the pterodactyl.
That took me far too long to go with. And I'm writing that one down for future, because that is amazing. As soon as I'm going to be a dad this year, I'm going to need to know all these. Do you think you saw this? Excellent. Amazing. Right. That's no, fuck the pterodactyl. The second F-bomb. Because no. Do you think so? That's the best one.
Just go, yeah.
And what would win in a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Probably the sheep.
Good man.
Probably the sheep. They can do the old flanking maneuvers.
Yeah, the holy moly, roly poly.
Yeah, holy moly, roly poly. Which, if they do that, the cow's like the cow's done. That's like Dragon Ball Z level finishing move is the holy moly, roly poly from two sheep as well. Just, I don't believe I'll see that in my lifetime.
Here's hoping. You never know.
Never know.
So before we do our final kind of big fantasy question, who you want to wrestle? So you've said like likes of DDP, Nigel McGuinness as well. You've mentioned, but you've said you'd be keeping an eye on the Scottish scene, the UK scene. Who's out there that you're thinking? Yeah, I think we could probably do something a bit special.
Love to work with anybody and everybody. Like I can learn something from everybody, and even if I don't beat them that first time, then I'll learn enough to beat them that second time. Obviously sort of partnering up with Brent Carr in the tag tournament, it'd be fun to actually have a match and to be in the ring with these people. I think Brody Adler would be an interesting one to take on. She does scare me a little bit, and I imagine that's her thing. There's a lot of guys over at like Iron Girders who'd be fun to work with. Zero, ADM, like, you know, I'm finding so many new names out, and a lot of people whose stuff I can't get around to watching in time. So yeah, I'm fairly open to anybody. I think Caleb Valhalla would be
we love big Caleb here.
Yeah, I mean, just to, even he would. I mean, I'm fairly tough, but I'm not anywhere near as big as a Viking is. But I believe even if I couldn't beat him in a match, I'll out drink him. Like that could be a more fun way of facing Caleb. The great skull off.
There's the challenge if I've ever heard one. When Caleb gets around to listen to this episode, that's it. Major Matt Wolfe, Caleb Valhalla, drink off.
Yep.
And that's gonna be a long night for you, and a very even longer morning.
Yes.
So I know for those that'll see a wee fade out, we thought, I'll get you back in and we'll do the last bit. I'm realizing it's only gonna be like 5 minutes, this last little bit, which seems ridiculous. That I just thought I'll boot you out just to get you back in for 5 minutes.
Again, yeah.
But it seemed to have worked. We're kind of seeing you a bit more and moving.
We've seen a lot more stable now. There's a lot less pauses.
Yeah. Saying that, I'll probably ask this last question. It'll be like a 3 minute pause because neither of us can hear each other.
Yeah.
So, last question is, Vince McMahon phones you. He's phoned you up. He's phoned you up 3 a.m. after he's done his workout. And he said, Major Matt Wolfe, because he respects the name. Major Matt Wolfe, I want to book you in the main event in WrestleMania. You get to choose the match type, your opponent or opponents. So it could be Battle Royal, it could be a tag team match, it could be a singles match, whatever you want. You get to choose all of it. What is it? So this is when it has to be someone that's alive, feasibly, you could wrestle them.
I could feasibly wrestle them. Vince in a steel cage.
There you go, the whole circle thing.
Just yeah, and it'll complete my journey round. Either that or Undertaker and Kane, triple threat, buried alive, ambulance match.
Right. Now I've got additional questions. So how does the buried alive ambulance match work? Does one have to be put in an ambulance, one has to be buried alive, or do you have to put them in an ambulance or drive the ambulance into a big hole?
Originally, the idea was actually just one in the ambulance, doors closed, the other buried alive, soil on. But now, I actually like your idea more of you get them both in the ambulance, you then drive it off a pier or something. And if someone's production team could pull that off, that's the dream.
I see why Joe turned to you and went, have you won the lottery? When you were describing ideas.
So the idea that Joe was most like no to was we were discussing, obviously some people tried to do some cinematic matches during lockdown and everyone was sort of trying to come up with ideas for that. My idea did not get off the ground for obvious budgetary. Let's just go with the budgetary reasons, let alone anything else. And I wanted to have instead of a game of death match, a game of Dahl. And every you'll have multiple rings, and each ring would have a different Roald Dahl theme to it. And you'd have to go, essentially be in different rooms, and you'd have to go through and like a gauntlet style match. But as you get through each room, it's then into a totally different, imagine a Willy Wonka inspired, and someone's getting dunked into the chocolate fountain before being pinned. And for obvious reasons, Joe was like, just no.
I love it. That's like Burton-esque. Yeah. And then obviously you'd finish it facing Danny.
Yes. Yeah.
Of course. That makes the most sense.
Yeah. First to escape the great glass elevator wins.
And you become the champion of the world. It's you know, Jewel. Well, I mean, come on.
No, like, who needs a budget when you have dreams?
Amazing. And I'm just imagining, like, introduced, and it's Joe dressed as Willy Wonka just to kick off the thing. And
like, you could totally imagine him doing like the slow cane walk, and then he leaves the cane and does a couple of forward rolls, maybe a moonsault. I imagine Joe could, I've not seen him do a moonsault before, but I imagine he could, he could do one, and then he stands up again.
Joey Wonka, there we go. Yeah. There's your future.
When we get to Ian Skinner's big birthday bonanza bash, however many other bees we're putting into this that don't take away or steal from your big birthday bonanza, then maybe I can persuade Ian to, if someone's crazy enough to put on the game of Dahl, I think it's Ian Skinner, or just me.
And of course, because everyone's 5'8", they'll be the Oompa Loompas. It's just,
yeah,
everybody. I'm on board for this. This is amazing. Right, okay.
Roman Reigns better be getting in that those white overalls, putting on the green wig. Like, I don't care how big a star you are.
You're an Oompa Loompa, and you're going to like it.
You're 5'8".
Right, I don't think there's any way we could top that as a subject. So I think that's probably the best time to wrap up. Like I said, weirdest thing, I did a Booty G out 5 minutes ago, and here we are, just going, right, we're done. Done. Where can people find out more about Major Matt Wolfe?
So I am Major Matt Wolfe on Twitter, Major Matt Wolfe on Facebook, and Major Matt Wolfe on Instagram. I don't think there's any underscores. If you search for Major Matt Wolfe, you will find me.
Excellent. Perfect. Thank you very much for joining me.
Awesome. Thanks, Billy.